Straker Kennard, CPA, and I am going to do an accounting and small business workshop today. This is a program called Networking on Purpose, and it is sponsored by the Women's Resources, Inc. It is a community center for nonprofits that empowers entrepreneurs to succeed in their business. And that's what we're here today to do, to give entrepreneurs some tips and some insight to succeed. My firm is Draper Kennard CPA, and what we do is client lifecycle services. And that's everything from full service accounting, tax, bookkeeping, financial audit. That's also financial planning, literacy, and consulting. That's also business solutions, business analysis. We do things in that category is like your strategic planning, your corporate goals, your business continuity, your internal controls, or SOX compliance, and things like that. We also do guidance for your investment and wealth management, as well as what I call an envision session. And those envision sessions are things like situation analysis for your small business, and we want to look at your situation and make sure that we can help you develop your business plan, your market plan, your research, expansion, growth, innovation, things like that to help you succeed. And that's what this workshop is about today. Okay. So, entrepreneurs, you are in business, and as we know, business is not for the faint of heart.
Nope.
Right.
And the first thing that I want to say, keys to success from my experience, you have to love it. If you're doing something that you're not in love with, then stop now, because you will not succeed. Business, you have to love it. You will work at least twice as hard for yourself as you have ever worked for any corporation or W-2 job. That's just the nature of the beast. The other thing I wanna make sure you understand is that I wanna make sure your mentality is long-term success. We're always looking for the long, decisions we're making are for the long term, for the long game. No short money, no shortcuts. There's no such thing if you want longevity and if you want to succeed for the long term, you want your business to survive. Okay, so the first thing we want to do is address the business essentials. You're in business and we want to talk about, you know, you need to analyze what products you want, what services you give, who are your customers. And I'd like you to think about the market. I'd like you to think about a business plan and the essentials you need to have in mind are like, do you need an office space? Do you need equipment? Do you need vehicles? You know, you need financing. You need relationships with your accounting, with legal, with regulatory agencies, with, you know, it's a lot of components that it takes to maintain and run and make a business succeed over the long term. Mm-hmm. And so that's where your accounting comes in. We are hands-on in all of these areas. We help with your market research. We help with your business plan. We help with your financial situation. We help with your putting together a package for financing. We help connect you with resources like the Small Business Administration. Of course, we can interpret the IRS code, the Georgia Department of Revenue code. We have all of that in-house under one umbrella. What I like to say is when you think of the, how many times have you said, I wish I knew someone who whatever that was.
Right.
I want you to think of us. That's what my firm does. I am your accounting, finance, business analyst, investing, and envision your business success partner for your entire life cycle. It does not matter where you are at the moment or where you're trying to go. We look at your individual situation, and that's what I give guidance for, so that you can go out and be the entrepreneur and run your business and do what you love. And I know it's hard for people to believe that, think of accounting and love in the same sentence, but that's mm-hmm. me. It's a blessing. God gave me this talent and these gifts, and I love what I do because it actually helps me serve, and that's my purpose-driven life, is to serve, whether it's in my community or my church or my faith or my profession, and that's why I'm in this profession. And this is what I do, and I do it very well, if I might say. And I am very, very passionate about helping businesses succeed. So that's my goal. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about your business structure. That's something that people like to ask, you know, should I incorporate? Should I do an LLC? Should I stay a sole proprietor? What are the benefits, pros and cons? And these things are, there are a lot of legal regulatory tax implications and things like that, and that will determine your business structure. So if you're a sole proprietor, for instance, we all know that that income goes directly in your 1040 tax return. There's no additional return. It's simple. It doesn't cost anything to set up, and that's how a lot of us start off as small businesses. The only downside to that is there's unlimited liability. You are liable for every single thing, and people can come after you personally for your personal assets in that event because you are the business. The other type is a partnership, and that's where two or more people come together for a common goal. The income and expenses can be allocated, like, it could be 50-50, it could be a third if it's three partners, but it does not have to be that. It depends on how you set it up in your bylaws. It has unlimited personal liability as well, so you are liable for each and everything you do, but also you are liable for each and everything that every one of your business partners does. So that is a definite downside of a partnership. And also it requires a separate set of tax returns. So that's something to think about if you're going into business. And also if anything changes in that structure, from one partner to two partners or three partners, then the partnership is automatically dissolved. So that's not really an attractive business model for most of us starting out with small businesses. The next thing is S corporation and C corporations. Both of these corporations have limited liability, so the business entity is separate from you as a person, and that's really important. And also, if one of the partners comes in or out, it's perpetual. The business does not dissolve. They do require separate tax returns. There are restrictions on adding investors in an S corp, but not in a C corp. And in a C corp, it is the highest level of taxation. You're taxed twice on the income from the business, and also once it comes to you, you can be taxed on certain levels of income as well. And there are also a lot of maintenance for the C corp. You have a lot of registration, you have a lot of state licensing fees, you have a lot of filings quarterly with the state and things like that. And then you have an LLC, a limited liability corporation, and that is exactly what it says. It limits your liability personally. Your income and expense can be allocated in any manner. It doesn't have to be 50-50 if there's two partners or a third. But the only downsides, the greatest downside to that is not perpetual like an S or C corp. A limited liability is good for companies for people who have more than one revenue stream. So if I wanted to set up an LLC under my name, Temple Kennard, and I have a business for tax, and I have a business for real estate investing, and a business for whatever, then an LLC is one single entity to establish, and you would have to file an article that says I'm DBA, doing business as accounting, or doing business as real estate. Anytime I'm not using exactly my name and representing my face on the front of that business, then I have to file a DBA, doing business as. So an LLC is very attractive for a lot of people because they do have more than one revenue stream. Sorry about that. Okay, so moving right along, we talked about we're in business and the structure, and let's talk about your business plan. And this is one of the areas where I have one of the greatest impacts in helping my clients, because now we're talking about how we get financing. And your accounting is the single most important part of you getting financed. So your business plan, your market research, and all of this financing package, it's critical for the success of your business, because none of us starting out in a small business has millions of dollars to just throw to the wind and we don't need help. We all need help. Mm-hmm. And that's the goal of this business plan. And so what your business plan is, and I know you hear people say a marketing plan and a business plan, and I just want to make a distinction between the two. Your business plan is a broad level overview of your business, and it includes things like your staffing, your operations, it has your location and your marketing and financial aspects, and it clearly outlines your mission, your goals, and what you're trying to accomplish. It is the number one tool that lenders use to determine whether you are financially sound, whether they want to invest, whether your business is viable. And it also tells whether or not you have the ability to repay your loans and things like that. And it is critical to understand your numbers and your budgets, your P&L, your forecast, and implement best practices. And all of this stuff is found in your business plan. And we do what we call an envision session. And that is for us to help you visualize where you're trying to go. We do a situation analysis where I look at your situation where you are now. I see what I can lay over that situation. And then I make plans to maximize your profit, find efficiencies, set up structure, set up your accounting, do resources for your financing. We do research for that, for grants, for what have you. We are trying to help you reach your long-term success. And that is the bottom line. And we are your partner for the duration of your business and your personal life. And that's the network that you want to have, because the next item that I want to talk to you about is your, oh, wait a minute, your market. I need to talk to you a little bit about defining your market. So the business plan is a broad overview of your business. And then I want to talk to you about your market plan. So your marketing plan is different. It is strategy. When you think of your business plan, that is the overview. When you think of marketing, think of it as your strategy. It is actually specific details, marketing actions on how you will get revenue into your business, how you will achieve your mission, how you will achieve your goals, how you will identify the price point for products that you're selling, how you need to set or establish or choose your target market and things like that. And it explains how your business generates income from customers, advertising, for instance, versus you may go to trade shows, or you may do referrals, or you may do mail out marketing. So it has specific tasks for you to create your strategy to market. And it is a common, it is a large portion of your business plan, because if you haven't done your financial research and your market research and you don't know the economy and what things are affecting your customers, you have to think about, is this location great? What's the accessibility? Are there customers there? You have to think about staffing. Is there even a workforce there? We're having problems now with COVID on the staffing situation. So if you're a technical company and you need a highly trained, highly skilled, specifically trained or licensed or credentialed workforce, you may not want to put your business in rural, whatever. You know, you need to think about these things, and that's part of your market research and your market plan. It's very important. And so I just wanted to make the distinction between those, because a lot of people, we all love what we do, or we get in these businesses and we have these dreams of grandeur, but we have to roll up our sleeves and do the work. And if we do this work and lay this groundwork up front, then we are positioning ourselves for success. And both your business plan and your market plan will have to be, you know, reviewed periodically, at least twice a year. I would say every 6 months, you need to just take a glance over your business plan and your market plan, and just make sure that the economy right now is very dynamic. You know, there's nothing you need to adjust. If there's something you need to adjust, or if there's something that's going to be to your detriment, then we need to start making moves now. For instance, we have a supply chain issue. You know, all of these things affect your ability to get product and serve your client. Or when the gas crisis happened and we didn't have gas, the pipeline was shut down. We couldn't do transportation and get things to and from our customers, you know. So these are the things you have to start thinking about in order to position ourselves for success. And that's why I always recommend, you know, your executives or your directors take a look at least every 6 months and review a little bit over your business plan and your market plan, just to see if there's anything we need to tweak or adjust. Okay. And now I want to talk about resources and relationships. So when you were talking about business resources, I'm a firm believer in joining your professional organizations. This is the greatest resource, especially like for me, I'm an accountant in finance and business in that field. These things keep me current on the tax laws, COVID, and you know, childcare credits and things like that that directly impact my clients. You know, everyone wants to call and say, hey, how does this affect me? I heard something on Channel 2 Action News. What do I need to do? So there is, like, it's almost like gold, having a resource that pours, directly to your mailbox, everything you need to know that impacts your profession. And so I'm real big on your professional organizations, your chambers of commerce. They have information that says, hey, this is what's happening, or what we're building and what's coming down the pipe, and where you can, you know, hey, you might want to move over there and start marketing or targeting or send a mail out to that new subdivision or something like that, you know, so that's important. We have to keep up with our vendors. We have to keep up with our with other professionals in our field, because I always say, take a look at the top two or three competitors in your market. They're at the top for a reason. If they're number one in that industry, there's a reason for that. And with us starting out in small businesses, we need to look at what's working well for them, and we need to leverage those tools and make them our own, tweak them to work for our business. You don't need to recreate the wheel, but someone has already created it and been in business for decades and doing it very well. We'll just do it on a smaller scale. And that's why you need to stay in touch with your professional organizations, as well as networking events like this one. And always stay abreast of what's going on in your industry. One of those things is through your resources, but also through the top two or three organizations in your industry. The other thing I have is, relationships. So we looked at resources. So now we're going to talk about business relationships. And this is very important. When we're talking about relationships, a lot of people think about, oh, me and my partner. No. Relationships are your staff, your team, your customers, your suppliers, your professional relationships with your CPA, with your attorney, with your insurance broker, and things like that. We need these relationships to succeed. For instance, your staff, you have an obligation. Well, I always say hire your weaknesses. That's number one. We want people to bring something to the business that I may not be as strong as. I'm a very technical person. I'm an accountant. I don't have the soft skills and all of the writing skills and all of the places and thank you. I speak in bullets and it's very direct. So I need that person who is the creative to overlay what I do. And, you know, when I'm making communications, they make it's a little less brash. It's a little less bullet. So I'm get the facts to the people, ma'am. That's my thing. So, but also we hire well, and we have an obligation to develop our staff. That's one of the things that people don't understand. Your leadership is so demanding, not just whether your business succeeds, but all of the people you hire, they are in your hands as well. We have an obligation to develop them. And once we do that, that's through training, that's through mentorship. And I want people to come in. We can partner with schools and get interns, or we can have people come and work summer jobs. If they want to learn your profession, I think it's my duty and part of giving back to mentor and train and make sure that I'm also developing my staff. And also we have to remember, as another good aspect of leadership is, we hire them for a reason. So when we bring people into our business, this is how we keep them and keep them engaged or retain them and reduce our turnover. You have to trust their experiences. I want you to listen to your staff, and I want you to give them the latitude or make them feel comfortable enough to speak up and offer their experiences to you. And some of them are good ideas. We can learn from anywhere, any level, anyone at any time. There's something we can learn. And when your staff is comfortable enough to say, hey, I did this at another place, or hey, I had this idea, or hey, this is my focus or my passion, and I want to just bring this here, they need to be comfortable enough to come to me and say, you know, hey, can I run this by you? And let's talk about this, or let me see if this will work for your business. You know, I trust my staff. I have trusted partners and trusted team. And when people look at me and they say, oh, you're awesome, you have all this together, I say, I'm awesome because I have an awesome team. And I'm always growing and always learning, and I'm always reinventing myself, because that's life changes, you know, and the economy changes and your business changes. And so your staff needs to be able to come and give them opportunities to put their ideas to work. Nobody wants to turn over every 6 months. You're training someone new and it's a learning curve and your productivity is down. And so those are the consequences. If you don't develop your staff and keep them motivated and engaged, we're gonna be looking for new staff. So. And we try to limit that. And then relationships with our customers. It's very important that we know what businesses and individuals need. And this is ongoing. It will not be a need that's today that's going to last for 10 years. They need, the attention span of the consumer market is very low. They need new, every new, every new, every new, every time. You know, and that's what they're looking for. So it, we have to make sure we're in touch with the customers, know what they need, know what the market wants. But more importantly, when we're thinking about the customer, make sure that you're doing periodic surveys and get some feedback from them. That's your biggest resource. A lot of people do surveys and get feedback, but they don't implement them, or they don't change, or they don't make the improvements. And that's very frustrating to a customer, especially a lifelong customer. And if you're having a situation, not that the customer's always right, but if your customer has an issue with your business, number one, you come talk to me, we're gonna resolve it, and I'm gonna make sure you're good, because I'm here to serve you and make sure you succeed. But also, I care, and I'm passionate about making sure everybody is getting a win. You know, nobody wants to feel like they're taken advantage of or disrespected or unappreciated. And then the other thing I want you to think about when we're talking about our customers is this. What makes your business different? What is your niche? What is it that you do better than anyone else that's different from anyone else in that market? What can I add to my product or my service that makes me stand out from all of the other accountants? Well, what I add to that from my point of view is client life cycle services. Most people come in and they see their accountant once a year, and they have their returns or their business tax or their financials prepared and they're done. Every customer that I have, they can pick up the phone and call me on any issue or say, hey, I'm thinking about making this move or getting this financing or getting this loan or this line of credit or doing this or that. What do you think about that? I am your business partner for the long term, for your client life cycle. And that's something that I want you to remember, put a pin in that. Client life cycle. It does not matter if you have children graduating high school and they're just starting to work and they have jobs. Yes, they're my clients too now. We want to talk about getting out of debt, and we want to talk about making budgets, and we want to talk about savings for a goal. That's a point in your life cycle. When you do start a business, hey, I'm right here. I can do your business financing and your business accounting and your business returns. And when your business grows, hey, I'm right here. We can do your market analysis and research and go to the bank and get a huge loan. And when your business, you're ready to sell your business or dissolve a partnership, hey, I'm right here. I can connect you with a legal resource that does that, and we can make sure that both of you have a place to come and understand the terms and understand the financing, understand the liabilities, and get all that stuff resolved. We are here for the client life cycle. And when I tell you the biggest and most rewarding thing that I had is to see clients reach their goals, and then they come back and they're like, okay, I'm out of debt. Okay, I'm buying a house. Okay, I'm opening a business. Okay, my business is succeeding. I need a bank loan. Okay, I'm here. I need some help. I'm investing. What do I do with my portfolio? That is so rewarding to me. And it helps me know that I'm doing a good job. And it helps me know that, you know, I'm changing people's lives. And it's just so rewarding, because I think that is my purpose in life. I am here to serve, to help, and to make sure that everyone succeeds. And so customers are really just, that is, I know relationships are always focused on customers, but that is where you need to shine. And whatever you can find that makes you different or gives you a niche in the business, you need to capitalize on that and make sure you offer that to your customers. The next relationship is suppliers. Now, suppliers are very important to people who sell products. And I sell services, so it's not in my, it's not really my dynamic, but for people who sell products, we need to think about relationships with your suppliers. Once you find someone that has a good product and gives you good service and doesn't mind working with you, go to them, talk to them, ask them, have a lunch with them twice a year or something, and let them know what changes you're coming on in your business. What you don't realize is that the suppliers are out there all the time, and they supply a million businesses. They have ideas and products and services that people are asking for. Mm-hmm. They have ways to give you innovative ideas, or hey, this is where we can improve, or hey, this is something new that people might not have thought about in a service, but I can jump on that and provide that. And these are things that you want to do and implement to make you different and stand out in the market. Whatever you do, you want to be the best at it. You want to lead the market, be first to market, or offer that service, or offer it better than anyone else. But whatever need you can serve, those suppliers have access to information that we don't realize they have. And if you want to grow your business and you want to survive in the long term, you need these relationships. And also, I found that a lot of suppliers don't mind, as long as you have loyalty to them and you're a repeat customer and you're going to buy exclusively from them. They extend your terms, and they, instead of having to pay on the spot with cash up front, You can have a trade account where they give you trade credit and you can pay in 30 days, 90 days, or 60 days or 90 days. And that's priceless. So you're making money and you don't have to lay out the cash up front. It protects your cash flow. So those relationships are really good. And so the next thing we want to get to is the accounting, the reason I exist in life. So let's talk about accounting. Why is accounting so important? Can you guys tell me why you think accounting is so important?
So many reasons I think of. You have to be able to know what you have coming in, what's going out. You have to have your documents in order if you want to receive monies like grants and things like that. You need to be able to show, like for me, a nonprofit, if I want an investor or a sponsor, what I'm doing with the money.
Exactly.
What's going out. So those are just a handful of things that I can think of.
I can think of productivity reasons. If I don't have my accounting together, I can't get my figures to know that I'm doing better this year than last year, or if my business is actually growing.
Right.
Yes.
Growth. Yeah.
Important.
Right.
Those are all excellent, excellent answers. And that's exactly why it's important. No matter what you do in life, whether it's your personal life or your business life, if you don't know where you are and your position today, you cannot get to whatever goal you're setting.
Right.
You're just spinning your wheels.
Yeah.
And so accounting lays out your financial position, your financial health, your financial strength, your business soundness and capabilities. It also is part of your brand image. And people don't understand that. When you go to the bank for a loan, for financing, it is 80% accounting and 20% your personal track record. That's what they're looking at. They want to know your finances are in order. Can I see what you've been doing with your money? Can I see where your business is growing and advancing? Even if it's just 5% per year, they need to see that you're progressing and growing and moving forward. That it shows them your character and your integrity. And that's a big part of financing. People don't realize that you are being weighed and measured every step of the way. They don't know you. And they need to look at you and try to evaluate as best they can your character, your integrity, your qualifications to even run this business, and what you're going to do in the future. Although we know everybody, you can change who you are, but your past actually dictates, it's the best measurement of what you will do to people who don't know you.
Right.
You know, and once you have a relationship, that changes. But your accounting is critical to your financing. And financing, whether it's from friends, family, or what have you when we're starting out the business, or whether it's from a bank loan, or whether it's from investors, that is the key to success over the long term. We need financing to make these dreams come true.
Yes, God.
So, all right, another point of accounting, we're going to move into, I'm ready. Excuse me for a second, let me gather myself. Okay, for accounting, we are here. That is my area. What things do we want to think about when we think about accounting? Well, number one, we need to set up an accounting system. And I'm not really concerned what system you use. It could be QuickBooks, it's very common. And I like it personally because it flows directly into TurboTax. They're both Intuit software products. And there's no zero work maintenance transition to get your financial reporting and your tax returns and your filings done if those two are partnered together. But the number one small business accounting software is Sage. And that's from the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants. They go out and do these audits and everywhere, and most of the small businesses are using Sage. And so I'm not sure why. And I'm not sure, like, if there's discounts or if it's just cheaper or more available or readily available, or if it comes in packages in the mail to us, actually, so we have it for them. So, you know, if you go to trade shows and they know you're an account, they start sending you things, products to promote. Or Microsoft also has its own small business accounting software. So if you get Microsoft Pro, it'll have small business accounting in there as well. If it's on an Excel spreadsheet, to me, that's accounting. You're tracking your expenses. You're tracking your revenues. I have some data to work with. But, you know, invest in us in an accounting system. Once your business gets a certain size, it saves down a lot of transfer and a lot of hours that you spend paying a CPA to do clerical work to transpose data. Those are things that's time, effort, money, and revenue that you can save by not having an Excel spreadsheet and just having any accounting software. It's well worth the investment up front for the time you'll save paying somebody to do that down the line. Another thing, I want you to think about when you set up your accounting software, how you organize your accounting structure. Whoever your regulatory body is, if you're a 501c3 and you file a 990, your accounting structure should be set up exactly how you report. That way there's no transfer either. There's no disconnect. If you have a regulatory agency or whatever return or filing you're required to file, that's how I would set up my client's accounting structure. You maintain your business expenses and revenues in that fashion, and it's easy for you to provide reporting and data to them at any time. And also, you don't have to make a transition when it's time to do your filings on the quarter and at year end. So that's another thing that I try to do for my businesses up front. And that's part of your Envision session. We look at all of this and we set you up the most efficient way so that you don't have to worry. Once we set it up, it's like a one and done. We want you set up to succeed over the long term. And that's our goal. And also, if you don't have an accounting structure, I just want to throw this out there. There's an online bookkeeping tool that's completely free. It's called Bench. And then there's Google Drive and OneDrive. You can keep your books and keep your records there. But Bench is a free online bookkeeping tool, so you don't have to keep your books and your records. You just put your shoot your information up there, and it's kept for you. So there's no reason for no one not to have any accounting and to bring me shoe boxes with receipts in 2021, which I've received this year.
On trash bags.
I have trash bags too.
My mother used to get trash bags and we would have to sort it out.
Oh my God.
What were they drinking? Coffee?
We got to stop all of this. We can end this now. Also, go ahead, if you have more than 5 employees at any point when your business grows there, establish payment methods, revenue, payroll system. We want to get those things done, and that can be done in your accounting software. When you're a small business, you can keep track of 2 or 3 people on paper, but once you get past 5 employees, you need to set up payment systems and payroll systems. There's a lot of laws and regulatory items that go in that we don't know. And these systems actually catch that, capture that, and sort things out. I mean, no one knows the withholding rate for FICA is 2.486%, or Social Security is 6.whatever percent. But these systems already have that built in. And as you do your updates every time you turn your computer, a lot of them update behind the scenes and you don't know it. They have these tools built in for you. And also, accounting is very important because, like I said, if you can't see your position now, you cannot plan to go forward. And so your planning and your forecasting and a comprehensive budget, you know, these things are critical for you to develop your business plan and do your reporting. Also, make sure your budget includes your tax obligations. A lot of people budget this revenue from sales and these expenses for utilities. There are a lot of things there that we need to make sure we are capturing in our budgets, because if our budgets are incorrect, then our cash flow is short. We're not in a position to buy these materials or goods or services and do these shows and events, and we're in the red. We're negative, you know. So this is really critical, and make sure your budget is comprehensive. It should include, taxes. Even if you can think about it, when you had a check on a W-2, when you had a W-2 job and you had a check, there were certain things like your FICA, your Medicare, your life insurance, your health insurance, and things coming out of your check that a lot of people didn't even account for. So here's $300-$400 out of your check. You're thinking this is your revenue. That is not your revenue. Your revenue and your cash flow is already short because you haven't budgeted for $500 for just contingency. You know, even when I do a budget for any individual, there's always a contingency line because there is something in that line that they haven't thought of, or there's something that's going to happen as it's inevitable. You may blow a tire, you need $200, You can't make a budget based on, hey, these are the utilities and this is the house note and just hard things. There are a lot of unseen things there that you have to make sure you're including in your budget. It has to be comprehensive. And I always say, monitoring, adjusting, and revising, it is critical. You have to do it at least twice a year. You need to look over things. There are some things that are cyclical. There are some things that are seasonal. There are some things that happen once a year or once a quarter. We need to make sure we're accounting for all of that and we have them in our budget, because they will sneak up on us and we won't think about it. Like my HVAC maintenance that is needed today. We have to make sure these things are in there. It only happens twice a year, so sometimes you forget it, but make sure. And it usually takes a cycle or two, a budget cycle or two. A budget cycle is a year. So it usually takes the first year you're going to forget things, but you have a contingency line. The second year, you'll be better at it. So things like that. And so on a monthly basis, you have to forecast your cash flow in order to meet your obligations and the expenses that your business incurs. You need operating capital. Your revenue is just revenue. That is not your money. And I want people to understand the difference. When you sell something, a good or service, that is just revenue. That is not your margin, your profit. Margin and profit is what's left after you've taken out all of your expenses. So when you're forecasting your cash flow, make sure that you're accounting for that your budget is as comprehensive as it is, as it can be, to gain all of your revenues. Think about revenues from cash. Think about revenues from credit cards. You know, you have people that may be charging and you haven't gotten paid for that yet. You may have money coming in each quarter from donors and things like that. And, you know, you may have if you don't know that you have receivables out there that you need to collect, then they'll just stay uncollected. They'll just stay outstanding. You know, but think about all your revenue sources and make sure you're accounting for that on a monthly basis. And then we want to talk about your expenses. Things, we always know what we have to go, expenses we have to go and pay something for and buy a product, a hard expense that we can see, something tangible. We don't necessarily think about insurances, like I was saying, for instance, and we don't think about other things that are coming out. We don't think about software subscriptions. A lot of my clients don't account for all of this. You have like about 10 subscriptions that you're not even aware of with Amazon and Sam's Club and maybe something on Hulu or Netflix or what have you. There's a handful of subscriptions out there that they're not thinking of, and that's hundreds of dollars that they're not, you know, they're thinking that's cash flow. It's not cash flow. Right. And so when I present your financials and they'll think, okay, well, what's wrong? That's not my financial position. Yes, it is your financial position. And that's what your accountant does. We look back in order to develop your comprehensive budget. It could be anywhere from 6 months to 12 months to 18 months. And that's usually my rule of thumb. When I have a new client, I have to look back 18 months. There are some things in that quarter or in that year end that they're not thinking about that I have to be thinking about in order to really properly reflect their cash position. And so that's why we're here. And interest. A lot of people don't think about the interest they're paying on loans, car notes, credit cards, and things like that. Well, all of these are your expenses and they impact your cash flow. When we do your financials, your interest expense reduces your income. So those are the things I want you to think about when we're talking about accounting, you know, comprehensive accounting and accurate cash flow. And, you know, we work hard. We want to do projected financial statements, but we know all of these things, budgets, they're guidelines. They're a guide for how we're doing. They are going to change. Like I said, there are some things that are inevitable. There are some things unforeseen we can't control, but we just have to be prepared and have a contingency in there to account for that too. So, and let's see. And then the last part of accounting that I wanted you to think about, and I touched on this a little bit, is your record keeping. Like I said, there's a software called Bench, and it is online bookkeeping. And when we think about your record keeping, just think about things like, are you going to do traditional on paper, on books, or in your office, or are you going to do electronic records? For convenience and flexibility, electronic records are always best. But when you're talking about reliability, there is nothing in this world more reliable than paper. You have it. It's proof. You can pull anything off a cloud and off of anywhere and make anything. And when you go to the bank for a loan, they want to see your paper financials and your paper receipts. It is still the most reliable document you can find. Another thing I want you to think about with your bookkeeping and your records is security and privacy. Right now, there's a lot of laws about privacy, and especially if you're in the medical field, but really, in any field, any business that you do, because you have to protect your client's information. There's so much identity theft and fraud like that. We need to think about security. And also, there's a huge legal liability that you could incur for not protecting your records. For instance, in accounting, if I was to leave a file there with a person's social security number, date of birth, and things like that, I am grossly and almost criminally liable for that negligence. Mm-hmm. So we have to take identity theft and protection and security of data, we have to take it very serious. So I just want you to keep that in mind. But like I said, electronic files, they're convenient and there's flexibility. And another benefit of electronic bookkeeping is storage costs. Right now we have Google Drive, OneDrive and all that, and they can maintain our records and store them for nothing, really for free. But we still need paper documents for anything that is your loans, your deeds, your business setup, your real estate, your property. You know, there are some things you just have to have. Any legal document or any legal defense that you need to present for yourself, you're gonna need some paper, so. And also, I want to talk to you about protocol. I want you to be sure you set protocols. I need you to limit the access to your records. When you set up your hierarchy and you train your staff and you have certain levels of in your company, make sure that there is a very small level of people who have access to critical information or information that has people's social security numbers or that could have result in identity theft or things like that. You need to make sure that you limit the access. Also, you need to teach your staff about your protocols on privacy and security and bookkeeping and storage and maintenance and how they access records. And you need to enforce it. If you teach them and if you monitor it and you enforce it, then it relieves me of liability when something happens. At that point, the liability shifts to the other person. And at that point, you have communicated that to your staff, and they are grossly and criminally negligent for fraud at that point if they continue to, you know, disseminate any information that falls under your security and your privacy protocol. And another thing I wanted to mention to people, a lot of people put things in safe deposit boxes for storage. I just learned recently this year that safe deposit boxes are not insured. I don't know if people realize that, but all of your money and all of your records in the bank, they're insured by the FDIC. You can have millions of dollars in safe deposit boxes. They are not insured. Do not put anything in there that you have not personally secured an external insurance policy on. They are not insured. It is just a loss. So that's a little tidbit that I learned this year and wanted to share that. But just to sum it up, accounting is important. It makes your tax preparation easier, of course. It reduces your liabilities. It's critical for your financing. It's critical that you have a clear financial position so we'll know where we're going. Your record keeping and bookkeeping provides efficiency. And also it provides for succession planning. And that's something we don't think about. If you're at an age and a lot of people are retiring and they're leaving the company and they're turning it over to other people, if you don't have good record keeping and good accounting, then they won't be able to figure out where are your contracts, what agreements do we have, what are our bylaws, what are our policies and procedures. It is critical for succession planning, and I want you to think about that in your business. We always say when you go in, have a strategy to get out. You need an exit strategy, and these are things that you need to think about. Who are your successors? How do you transfer that knowledge? We have a huge section of the population that's retiring right now, and all that knowledge is going out the door. Mm-hmm. You know, we have to plan for succession. That's something that I really want you to start thinking about in your business. All righty, where are we now? We're gonna move into financing. So everybody wants to know, how do I get financing for my business? The answer is there is no one solid answer for that. So, financing. Usually, like I said, first and foremost, it is a combination of your accounting and reporting and your personal track record. this is what the bank or any lender or any investor is going to want to know. And these are the two components of your successful securing, you being successful in securing your funding. So a lot of people ask, why do they put so much emphasis on your personal track record? Well, like I said, the businesses don't know you, and your personal track record is like your best indicator of what you will do. And also, your personal finances are so closely tied into your new business or a small business that if they're not looking at your personal situation and that's not factored into what your business needs, you don't think about your personal situation when you're making your business budget. Well, my personal life has to continue. My business has to perform enough to sustain operating costs, but also pay me a salary and keep my personal life afloat. Mm-hmm. So your personal finances are a critical part of your business plan. And that's something that people aren't aware of. And when you go to the bank for lending and to investors and they deciding, they are looking at your accounting and reporting for those reasons for the business, but they are looking at your personal track record. These two partner hand in hand, whether or not your business succeeds and I can loan this business money, might be dependent on how much you're, how well you're doing over here, or how bad you're handling your personal finances, or how much debt you have, or whether or not you're taking $100,000 out of the business, and that's why the business is not succeeding. That's why they have to look at these two things together. It is the equation: successful financing, secured financing, your accounting and reporting, plus your personal track record. That's just how it goes. And you know, some of the questions they ask are, you know, hey, what are you applying for this loan for? Well, the business is expanding, growth. I need a facility, equipment, cars, vehicles. You know, I have staff that's increasing. I have all these obligations to pay. They want to know what assets you're trying to purchase and who your suppliers are. They want to know what business debt you have already. You know, the bank is going to want to know, how many loans have you taken out? You know, whose money are you wasting or not investing properly before we give you more, you know? And I just always tell people that you are being weighed and measured every step of the way. This is something you need to realize. Every step, you are going to be weighed and measured before somebody thinks, hey, I would like to work for you. Hey, I would like to be your customer. Hey, I could invest in this business. Or I don't want to work for you or be your customer or invest in your business. So we need to be mindful of these things, and we need to carry ourselves accordingly. Make sure our personal background is intact. You know, we all have a past, but make sure whatever issues you have, you've taken care of them. Make sure you have your resume. That's part of your financing package. You know, we need to see if you're qualified to run this business. They want to look at your personal credit report. They're looking at your character. They're looking at your, you know, integrity. They want to see how you handle things. They look at your personal tax returns to see whether or not money is being misplaced or misappropriated. Banks also ask about a personal guarantee. A rule of thumb, they want to know that you have some skin in the game. And that means, do you have your personal, are you vested personally? You know, do you have a collateral? Do you have a loan? Did you secure equity from your house to get this business? The rule of thumb is they want you to have 10% of your net worth needs to be invested. You know, if you're asking for a loan for $100,000, minimally 10% of it comes from your net worth. And right now it could be as high as 20%. You know, that is just the nature of the beast. And so these are things. Also, another thing I want to make sure that I mention to you guys that a lot of people don't think about, something that I tell my clients all the time. When I say image, I'm not talking about, hey, how I look in this red dress. Your image is also your character, your integrity, your resume and qualifications. It's how you establish your business. Did you care enough to learn your trade, get a credential, get a license? Do you have insurance to protect this business and these assets? Do you have partnerships and have the right people in your corner and filing your documents? They want to know, are your licenses and registrations current? Are your articles, is that spelled out, your articles of incorporation current? These things are all your image. This reflects and is part of the decision in you securing financing. And so you have to worry about me as a person over here, what I do on the side. A lot of people say, oh, this is outside of business. It has nothing to do with business. You're dead wrong. Everything you do has something to do with your business, especially if you're going here asking somebody for their money to finance and support and keep your business afloat. It is just the nature of the beast. And let's see what else I want to touch on. I think I've summed that up and just said, to achieve financial success, you have to have the ability to communicate who you are through your financial and accounting records and through your personal track record. That is the sum of whether or not you're, yes, we're willing to invest in you, or no, we can't do business with you. Bottom line. Okay. And after financing, I think that's about it. That's a quick overview of accounting, financing, and business solutions and things that Draper Kennard can do for you, and how we handle our clients and our relationships and our customers. And these things are done in what we call an Envision session. And that's where we want you to sit and talk with us and tell us about your business, where it is now, what you're looking to accomplish, where it's going, and visualize yourself where you want to be in 5 years to 10 years. And we are going to partner with you to make sure that we accomplish those goals and we make sure you're successful along the way. You know, just think of it as like the lines on the stock market. You see them go up, you see the market crash, you see them go up, you see the market crash or what have you. But you don't have to crash, because every time you said, I wish I knew a person who, whatever, that's what we do. We're the person who, for whatever your need is. And so, in closing, I'm just going to give you a few of, I think I've already given you some of my closing remarks or things that I bring to people. I always say long game, not short money. We're always thinking for long-term success, and everything you do, we need to be positioning ourselves for long-term. And I already said it open with, you have to love it. If this is your business, you have to love what you do. You will not be successful if you do not love what you do. You need to just go back to work and do something else, because I'm telling you, it is not for the faint of heart. The other most important thing I need to communicate to people is brand image. And like I said, not just you and that outfit. Your personal track record, how you handle money, do you keep your word? You know, your how you every think about this song. You remember the song, Every Breath You Take? This is what I try to tell my clients for brand image. Every breath you take, every step you make, every single move you make, they say someone's watching you. That's your brand image. You're being weighed and measured by that. So turn that around and say, every step I take, every single move I make, how about you're branding you? So you're branding yourself at all times. Every single thing you do, to some extent or another, you are branding you. And that's why I keep trying to expand your concept of your brand image. These days, there's 100 people that do A, B, or C, whatever it is you do. What's to make someone say, I want this company versus that company? They're going to look at everything they can when they're doing that research and reading those reviews and watching you as you have performed or walked or lived or operated over the last 10 years. And they're gonna say, I want to deal with that person. I know her character, her track record. I know her integrity. I like how she presents. I like that she follows up, she cares. I like that the products she gives, their quality. I like that the service she gives is excellent. And for, I like that, you know, you are branding you with every single move you make. So that's something that I cannot express enough how important that is, and especially on down the line when you're trying to expand and grow. And another tidbit, I always say, know your trade, you know, get your credentials, get your license, get your business set up properly, have yourself in a position to succeed. You don't never know when somebody's going to blow into town and they might be doing a movie shoot and they might need you to do A, B, and C. Can you handle that capacity? You know, are you skilled? Are you qualified? Don't miss an opportunity because you don't have a license, or you don't have a business license, or you don't have a tax ID number. I can just strangle some people. Just find that it's free. You just go online and get it, you know? And then know your numbers, because like I said, you can't go forward until you know where you are. Lead, not follow. I want to challenge you, and nobody's perfect, but I do want to challenge you to strive for excellency in everything you do. And when I say lead, not follow, I want you to be the absolute best at whatever it is you do, even if it's on a smaller scale, even if it's what, if you do it better than anyone else. Provide the best service, provide the best quality product we can offer. Be the first one to call. Don't wait and say, hey, this is a good idea. Clients may need that. Oh, people are going through this and I think I can help. Call people and say, hey, I got this idea. I want to see if I can run this by you. Do you think you need that or you want somebody to do that? People appreciate that. You solving problems. You know, be the first to market with something, whether it's a service or good or what have you. You get that information from your customers, from your professional organizations, from the person who is number one in your industry, from those suppliers who listen to these customers and have these ideas. You know, you have to be willing to think and grow and always have those wheels turning on how you can lead and be first to market or first or better or number one in your business. You know, that's something that I want you to start thinking about. And of course, personally, you know, we lead by example. Like I said, your walk and how you operate and whether you keep your word and how you're doing business and your disposition and whether you have a smile all the time or whether you frown all the time, you know, those things, you know, personally, you're setting an example and people are reading that, you know, they can read that. So make sure your character and your disposition and your integrity and all that stuff is intact personally. So when I say lead, not follow, just think, you know, I'm going to wake up every day and I'm going to do my absolute best to deliver. Just be passionate about what you're delivering to people. And continuous learning. When I say that, I mean your business can always improve, whether it's ideas from your customers or from your staff. Improve your service. You can improve in technology. You can make sure that you don't have a lot of downtime on your website when people are trying to find you or no products are in stock or your website's not working. You know, try to get these things worked out. Efficiency. If you have your accounting system in place, then now you're going to be more efficient. You're not looking for records or trying to figure out your money and have to go home and say, let me think about it for the weekend and I'll figure out Monday if I can afford to do that. You know, so make sure you're always learning, always adjusting, always monitoring, always improving, always looking for efficiencies in your business. That helps you be ready for an opportunity when it presents itself. And relationships. That's always going to be my biggest thing because I think we cannot possibly succeed without relationships. And so that's all for the accounting workshop. That's the data that I have and small business and accounting workshop. But on a personal note, I do want to talk to you about something about my strategy. And so I think life is the sum of our relationships. That's one of my it's the headline of every day. My life is the sum of these relationships. If you're in business, that needs to be part of your four or five tenets. And so I always say, you know, personally, you know, I'm a Christian and my salvation is important to me. It's one of the most important decisions I've ever made. And if we were created to glorify God, then if he's looking at everything I do, then I want to make sure that that's pleasing to him. And so that's kind of how I keep myself on track. We're all human. We all falter. We have those days. We stump our toes. We may say something we shouldn't say, but just in the greater scheme of things, kind of think like that. Just set something higher than yourself so you can try to model your life and keep things in perspective. And my mom, she constantly poured into us, you know, the word and your faith and how we should walk, and it strengthens you and to encourage you and to help you make it. And, you know, pray and ask God for wisdom and strength and guidance and protect you as you go out. And, you know, I'm a living testimony that he will not fail you. He will not fail you. And I just challenge you to step out on faith and just take that leap. Prepare yourself. You don't have to see where you're going yet. That's what faith is. And prepare yourself for whatever opportunity he has. Give him something to bless. If we're doing nothing, he has nothing to bless. If we step out there on faith and we pray and, you know, trying to figure it out, give him something to bless, you know? And so that's it. If, like I say, if your dreams aren't scary, they're not big enough. So if you can figure it out, then, what are we doing here? So just keep that in mind. And then special offers. Oh, I was given a special offer today for one of the Envision sessions. It's usually a 3 to 5 hour event, and it's usually $500. But what I want to offer you guys is a mini 1 hour Envision session for 125. And what that does is just give us a one-on-one consult to look at your position and see where you are and see where I can help you. There may just be some things that I can tweak right away or give you some insight or point you in some directions, give you some resources or connect you with some people that can solve, you know, a lot of those problems right away. And so the goal of the Envision session, number one, is to educate you on what we can be doing better financially, accounting-wise, or in the market or what have you. And number two, enhance your products and services if we can. And of course, expansion. We want to expand your business, make you more innovative and more efficient. That's going to maximize your profit. And we want to enrich, you know, it's four E's, and that's educate, enhance, expansion, and enrich. And when we, you know, look over your situation and get these things in order, you know, it enriches your life. You know, we're working for our kids and putting kids through college and what have you. It enriches your family's life and, you know, customers and the community as a whole. You know, that's what we're trying to do here. And it's not just for today. Like I said, it's life cycle services, and that's what we do. And that's all I have. Thank you guys for coming.
Thank you.